Hello and welcome everyone to this session on flashcards and medicine part 3. Now, I was going to revise a few of the things from medicine, but then I thought that this topic definitely is something that is IMP for the INICET exam. So definitely I am expecting out of COVID and mucormycosis, you all should in all have at least 4 to 5 questions in the exam, because this is all the latest stuff that they are going to be discussing. So what I have done is I have added questions about mucormycosis from the basics of mucor to the most difficult part of mucor. Okay, so we will be discussing everything in the form of MCQ pattern, and it will be fun, interactive. And at 9 o'clock today, we are going to be having at 9 p.m. AIIMS COVID update. Okay, so the AIIMS COVID update for treatment of mild, moderate and severe disease is what we will be discussing at 9 p.m. today on YouTube. I will be posting the link for that also on my Telegram group, so make sure that you guys attend it. So let's begin with today's class. The Plus platform of Unacademy will give you structured courses, weekly tests, unlimited access and live classes. The iconic subscription of Unacademy, this is one of our best offerings. It gives you live classes and batch courses of Unacademy and the video lectures and question bank of PrepLadder. So you don't need anything more than this to ace your NEET PG exam. Then we have a limited time offer going on right now for the iconic subscription. You guys can buy a 3-year iconic subscription for just 58,500 rupees. And this is for our NEET PG students. Since we don't know when the exam is going to be, mostly it is going to be in August, you can buy a 3-month subscription and you will get 1 month free along with that. Then we also have an offer going on for the next 2022 students, in which you will get a 12-month subscription and you will get 2 months free with that. Okay, so these are all our batches that are going on right now. The NEET PG Seasons batch, FMG MCQ Marathon batch, Target Next 2022 batch, INICET MCQ Marathon batch. And we also have a question bank of 34,000 carefully curated questions. So if you guys would like to buy any of the subscriptions, you can download the Unacademy app, use my code Dr. Janvi Live and get a 10% off on your subscription value. Alright, so let's begin with our class for today. So the first question I have for you guys here is, what is the hallmark feature of mucormycosis? Good afternoon everyone. Shahid, Javed, Pritika, welcome to the class. And I want you guys to participate and answer. This is a little new topic for all of us. It's not just for y'all. ENT surgeons also said that they used to see mucormycosis cases hardly 1 or 2 cases in a month, and now they are seeing it almost every day. So since we have to keep up with the times and make sure that we have studied all the important things, so mucormycosis ka batao. Black scar formation, black eschar formation, black gangrene formation or hyperpigmentation of affected areas. Okay, absolutely correct. So all of you have answered it correctly. Pritika, Prabhakar, Shahid, Tina, Misbah, Purnima, Javed, yes. So black eschar formation is the hallmark feature of mucormycosis. So these are some of the pictures of mucormycosis that you can see. And basically, why do you have this eschar formation? Anyone, any idea? What is the main point of mucor? Is that it will invade into the blood vessels. Okay, so it invades into the blood vessels and it forms thrombi. Now because of formation of this thrombus, there will be ischemia. The blood supply to that area will be affected. So as a result of this ischemia, there will be necrosis and there will be gangrene, and finally there will be eschar formation. Okay, so this is how the mucormycosis works. This is the hallmark feature of mucormycosis. It invades blood vessels. This is also called as angio invasion. And then later it causes decrease in the blood supply due to formation of thrombus and eschar formation. Okay. Next question. Which of these is the most common distribution of mucormycosis? Now mucormycosis is found in different areas of the body. So it can be formed in the lungs, it can be formed in the skin, disseminated all over the organs, or the rhinocerebro-orbital region, that is the nose, brain and the orbit, and gastrointestinal. So which one of these is the most common distribution of mucormycosis? Okay, good. So everyone is saying answer as D. Alright, good. So rhinocerebroorbital. Yes. Now let me twist this question a little bit for you guys. In patients of COVID-19, which is the most common distribution of mucormycosis? A little bit of a twist. Same options, but now tell me in patients of COVID-19, which is the most common distribution of mucormycosis? Is it the same answer or does it change? Okay, now people are changing their answers. MS Lakshmi has also given two answers, B and A. I wish we had that option of giving two answers. Okay, so in patients of COVID-19 also it is rhinocerebroorbital only. Next question. In patients of diabetes and on steroid use, which is the most common distribution of mucormycosis? Does it remain the same or does it change in patients on diabetes and steroid use? Okay, good. Same. Alright, rhinocerebroorbital, correct. So COVID-19 may usually the patients who are immunosuppressed, who are diabetic and who are taking steroids are the ones who are predisposed to developing mucormycosis, and it is seen that in diabetic patients and those on steroid use, this is the area of distribution which is the most common. Another twist in the question. Which is the most common type of mucormycosis in people with cancer and in people who have had an organ transplant or a stem cell transplant? Same options. So if I have a patient of cancer, organ transplant or stem cell transplant, now which is the, no, it's not the same, the answer changes guys. So which is the most common distribution in this group of patients? Remember, y'all all must be considering that mucormycosis is something which is just seen in relation with COVID-19, but it has been there since 1855. The first case was diagnosed in 1855. So tab se the distribution of mucormycosis has been changing. So in patients who have had cancer, organ transplant or stem cell transplant, it is seen that pulmonary distribution of mucormycosis is the most common. Okay, now in HIV patients and in IV drug abusers, HIV patients and in IV drug abusers, which is the most common presentation of mucormycosis? Okay, so let me mark it over here. Cancer, organ transplant and stem cell transplant is pulmonary. Okay, and HIV and IV drug abuse, anyone? Okay, all confusion between cutaneous and dissemination. Okay, so it is actually cutaneous distribution. Absolutely correct. So now have you all understood everything about distribution of mucormycosis? So if you have patients of COVID-19, diabetes, steroid use, rhinocerebroorbital. So right now for us, rhinocerebroorbital is the most common one that is available, that is happening in the world. Cancer, organ transplant, stem cell transplant, pulmonary involvement, HIV and IV drug abusers is cutaneous distribution. Okay, alright. Molds of the order dash are responsible for causing mucormycosis. Now we really need to look at the family of mucormycosis. What are the causative organisms? So molds of which order are responsible for causing mucormycosis? Mucorals, mucorays, mucorols, mucorules. Sounds like some sound. Song, Macarena song, mucorals, 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 mucorals. So this is like some Spanish song. I have tried to confuse you guys as much as possible. Okay, unfortunately I was able to confuse only two or three people. So it is molds of the order mucorals. Okay, molds of the order mucorals, which are responsible for causing mucormycosis. Now let's have a look at what are the actual genus under the order Mucorales which are responsible for causing this disease. Which of these genera cause mucormycosis? Rhizopus, Mucor, Cunninghamella, Apophyomyces, or all of the above? I am adding one more option to this because I forgot to add it, both A and B. This is how they confuse in INI, both A and B, A, B and C, everything except E, all of the above. So you'll have to get a little used to it. So most of you are answering Rhizopus. Shahid is saying all of the above. Then Shubhrashmita is saying A and B. And then we have a few of you saying F. But the answer is, only Shahid has answered this correctly. Okay, so the answer is all of the above. That F also I added to confuse you guys. So all these genus falls under Mucorales. Okay, so you have the order Mucorales, and then under it you have many genera. One is called genus, many are called genera. So you have many genera: Rhizopus, Mucor, Cunninghamella, Apophyomyces. All of them can cause mucormycosis. Okay, but out of these, the most commonly causing ones are Rhizopus and Mucor. So these are the most common organisms that are causing mucormycosis, but all of them can actually cause the disease. So if they are asking which of these genera causes the disease, you will mark the answer as all of the above. Okay, all right. Most fatal infections are caused by Rhizopus oryzae, Rhizopus delemari, Rhizopus homothallicus, or Rhizopus microsporus. It is a simple question answer sort of a class today, because all of this is something that unfortunately you will have to mug. There is absolutely no logic or any kind of concept behind it. So this is a new disease and we need to be able to answer everything about it. So whatever question answers I give you, just read this and it will be done. The whole topic will be done. Yes, Gopika also answered correctly. In the last question, Gopika also answered correctly. Okay, so here we have many of y'all saying A, then we have Shahid saying B, then we have Shubhrashmita saying C. Okay, so the most fatal infection is actually, as most of you have mentioned, is caused by Rhizopus oryzae. Okay, Rhizopus oryzae is the one which causes the most fatal infection. So three things about what causes the infections: order Mucorales, genera all of them, but most commonly Rhizopus and Mucor, and the most fatal infection is caused by Rhizopus oryzae. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. In which of these body pH environments is there increased growth of mucor? Metabolic alkalosis, respiratory alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, respiratory acidosis. Okay, very good. Yes, very good. Metabolic acidosis is the body pH in environment in which there is increased growth of mucor. Absolutely correct. And are we getting to see this a lot in the COVID times? So they did a few studies and they saw that in COVID-19 patients, there was increased mucormycosis because of two things. One was because of increased sugars, blood sugar levels. And two was because of metabolic acidosis. Okay, now why is metabolic acidosis happening in COVID-19 patients? This is because of two things. One is because of uncontrolled diabetes. So they are getting diabetic ketoacidosis. Ketoacidosis, okay, that is causing the metabolic acidosis, adding to the metabolic acidosis. And second thing is because of hypoxia. So because of hypoxia, in all the parts of the body, on all the organs, you have ischemia, and in turn there is anaerobic metabolism which is leading to the formation of lactic acid, and that lactic acid is adding to the metabolic acidosis. Okay, so this is the real reason why in all the COVID patients who are mostly diabetic, they are on high steroids. So steroids is causing increase in the blood sugar levels, and then because of the added hypoxia, there is metabolic acidosis which is causing adding to the growth of the mucormycosis. Okay, all right, now moving on to the next question. Which of these categories is not susceptible to mucormycosis? Post COVID-19, bone marrow transplant, on immunosuppressive medications, uncontrolled diabetes, hypothyroidism, or none of the above? Okay. You all love your all of the above, none of the above, both A and B and C and this, na? Read it carefully. I just want to see if anyone answers it correctly. Okay. Now people are retracting, changing answers. Barabar. Okay. So remember to read it correctly. Now, if anyone has hypothyroidism, that is not really a critical comorbidity, correct? People survive on hypothyroidism. I think most of the actor, actresses have hypothyroidism and they are living their life very well. So, hypothyroidism is not a critical comorbidity, okay? So that in patients of hypothyroidism, you are not going to see increased chances of mucormycosis unless the patient comes to you in mixed edema coma, okay? Or because of taking too much of medication, she has thyrotoxic factitia. So, in that case, you might be critically ill and you might have chances of developing mucormycosis. But out of all of these, post-COVID-19, yes. Bone marrow transplant, yes. Immunosuppressive medications, yes. Uncontrolled diabetes, yes. All of them are immunocompromised patients. So there has to be immunocompromised patients in order to be susceptible to mucormycosis. Alright? Okay, so what is the moral of the story? Read the question and the options very carefully. Don't go directly for all or none of the above. Okay, which of these is a predisposing factor for mucormycosis? Stress, prolonged steroids, immunocompromised state, or all of the above? Sure, na? This time sure, all of the above. Pritika is very scared, so she has marked only stress. Okay, now it is all of the above. Yes, you already know about two of these predisposing factors. So one was use of prolonged steroids, which is happening in COVID-19, and immunocompromised state is also happening in COVID-19. So both of them are there for sure, and stress is the third factor that predisposes to mucormycosis. Alright, next question. Which of these is not a clinical manifestation of mucormycosis? Blackish nasal discharge, nasal stuffiness, nasal septal cartilage destruction, or none of the above? None of the above means all of them are clinical features of mucormycosis. Okay, Pritika is saying by mistake. Barabar hai. So examiner also understands when he is making the questions that where is it that the students go wrong. When they see all of the above, it's like showing you ghar ki dal roti and McDonald's burger. Okay, so obviously you will go for the McDonald's burger first. So all of the above is like your McDonald's burger option. No one wants to eat ghar ka dal roti options A, B, C. Everyone wants to go for option D, all of the above. Okay. A, D. Why is there a confusion between A and D? No other options, guys? ओके सो अ फ्यू ऑफ यू मे हैव बीन कन्फ्यूज बाई दिस बट नेजल सेप्टल कार्टिलेज डिस्ट्रक्शन इज नॉट अ क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ म्यूकोमाइकोसिस ओके सो ओनली द सेप्टल कार्टिलेज इज नॉट गोइंग टू गेट डिस्ट्रॉयड इफ यू गाइज आर थिंकिंग दैट देर विल बी इश्चीमिया बिकॉज ऑफ विच देर विल बी डिस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ द बोन इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी डीलिनिएटेड और फिक्सड और स्पेसिफाइड ओनली टू द सेप्टल कार्टिलेज इट इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू गो टू द एंटायर बोनी स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द नोज ओके सो नेजल सेप्टल कार्टिलेज डिस्ट्रक्शन इज नॉट अ क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ म्यूकोमाइकोसिस कैन एनी वन टेल मी वॉट इज दिस अ क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ If I'm saying the nasal septal cartilage is destroyed or you have a hole in the nasal septal cartilage. So, what group of patients does this happen in? Absolutely correct. It happens in cocaine abusers. Cocaine abusers. Okay. Alright. So, blackish nasal discharge is seen. Nasal stuffiness is seen. What are the other clinical manifestations? I'll come to it in the following questions. Which of these is not a clinical manifestation of mucormycosis? Blackish scar on palate, facial swelling, ptosis, sudden onset amaurosis or none of the above. I'm sorry, I'm taking a little bit of a break after the question because there is so much lag. I'm showing you the question but it's coming to stream to you guys only after 10 seconds. Okay, so okay, Subrashmita, Rajeshwari are saying none of the above. Then we have Aviral saying a palate amaurosis is there. Okay, so let's go option by option. Whenever we are talking about mucus, there are three main places which are involved. Okay, one will be the nose, the second will be the palate, and the third will be the orbit, and the fourth will be the brain. Okay. सो राइनो सेरेब्रो ऑर्बिटल तो यू नो राइनो सेरेब्रो ऑर्बिटल ओके बट पैलेट इज ऑल्सो वन ऑफ द थिंग्स दैट इज अफेक्टेड बाई म्यूकोमाइकोसिस सो ब्लैकिश स्कार ऑन पैलेट येस इट्स प्रेजेंट फेशियल स्वेलिंग एंड फेशियल पेन आई एम गोइंग टू ऐड ओवर योर ओके फेशियल पेन इज ऑल्सो प्रेजेंट देन टोसिस येस सो वॉट हैपन्स इज वेन द mucor enters into the orbital cavity, it presses on your third, fourth and sixth nerve, okay? So it presses on your third, fourth and sixth nerve and it causes palsy. So because of that palsy, you have ptosis. Then sudden onset amaurosis. If it's pressing on the optic nerve, then you are going to get sudden onset amaurosis or simply loss of vision. Okay. So all of these are clinical manifestations of mucormycosis. So your answer over here is none of the above. All right. So now let's move on to the next question. What is the earliest clinical manifestation of mucormycosis? Ptosis, blackening of hard palate, pale nasal mucosa or blackening of tip of nose? Yes, okay. So everyone knows this. Pale nasal mucosa is the earliest clinical manifestation. Yes. And this is an important question which I guess will come in your exam. So earliest clinical manifestation as you can see over here. So you do an endoscopy through the nose. Okay. So it's called as a nasal endoscopy. And then you will see pallor of the nasal mucosa. So you can see over here pallor of the nasal mucosa. And that pallor is happening because of the angio invasion of the fungus okay so when the fungus is blocking the blood vessels it's forming clots and it is stopping the blood flow to this nasal mucosa that is when it becomes ischemic and you see this pale nasal mucosa in that case. Okay, so the answer is pale nasal mucosa. That is the earliest clinical manifestation of mucormycosis. Alright, so all the clinical manifestations are now okay. So we saw what is the causative organism, who are the ones who are susceptible, so predisposing factors. Then we have seen all the clinical features. Now we are going to the diagnostics of this disease. Okay, so which of these is the best diagnostic modality for identification of mucormycosis? CT, MRI, histopathology, fungal smear culture, clinical suspicion, ELISA, PCR. So given you all the options now. That is a polyp, but I did not find a picture which showed a pale nasal mucosa, and unfortunately I don't do nasal endoscopies to get the picture, so that's why I just put it. Okay, Gopika, yes, but if you feel that patient will not come at this time, but that is just an early diagnostic feature. Like suppose you feel that there is a COVID patient who is diabetic, who's been on steroids for a long time with uncontrolled sugars, then if you want to try and see whether he has started developing mucormycosis, so you can do a nasal endoscopy early in him, catch the disease quickly and start him on antifungals. So that way it is sort of a feature in which you will be able to save the patient ahead by giving him early treatment, early diagnosis and early treatment. Yeah, it's a sign. Yes, Misbah, you are correct. It's a sign. It's not a symptom. It's a sign. Because you're being... Yeah, sorry. So, all of you guys, I am seeing many different answers over here. But the best diagnostic modality for identification of mucormycosis is by growing the fungus. Okay. Now, your radiology will only tell you the extent of the fungus. And it will tell you that there is something which is there which is destroying the brain, the orbit, the palate, everything. Okay, the histopathology will give you a little bit of an idea through the hyphae and about the invasion. The clinical suspicion obviously is not never enough, so it's not a diagnostic modality. And ELISA PCR is done in cases in which you get fungal smear or culture negative. Okay, so in culture negative or smear negative cases, you will try to do molecular tests like ELISA or PCR. But the best diagnostic modality for identification is by growing the fungus and identifying it. So fungal smear and culture is the best diagnostic modality. Okay, alright. How do you identify, so we spoke about fungal smear and culture, correct? So on fungal smear and culture, how do you identify this fungus? So if you see over here, I have also written it above so that you guys can remember it for later. So they are broad hyphae, you can see the hyphae over here are broad and they are at right angles. This is the main thing that identifies the mucor group. Okay, so they are hyphae are at 90 degrees. And if you see in the Aspergillus species, okay, so the Aspergillus species is the one that is the white fungus. In Aspergillus species, your hyphae are going to be first of all septate and at an angle of 45 degrees to the main branch. Okay, so in case of mucor, your hyphae are going to be aseptate and at an angle of 90 degrees. So this is the main differentiating feature between both mucormycosis and Aspergillus species. Okay, Aspergillus is the one which is causing the white fungus and mucormycosis is the one which is causing the black fungus. So if you have to identify between the two of them in the exam and they give you a clinical case scenario and they say on fungal culture you see an organism or a fungus which is having broad aseptate hyphae at 90 degrees angle, then it is black fungus. If they say it is septate hyphae at angle of 45 degrees, then it is white fungus or Aspergillus. Okay, alright. This is just a picture. If you see Rhizopus ka, this hyphae are at 90 degrees. Okay, and if you see Aspergillus mein, these hyphae are at 45 degrees. Alright, moving on to the next question. What is the hallmark feature on biopsy of mucormycosis? Angio invasion, epithelial involvement, some mucosal involvement, both A and C, all of the above. Okay, good. So all of you have answered this correctly. Both A and C is the hallmark feature on biopsy of mucormycosis. So you will see two things. You obviously will see invasion of blood vessels and also involvement of the mucus. Okay, so because of this submucosal involvement, you get that early sign of having a pale nasal mucosa because it involves the submucosal area. Okay. Perfect. So this is the hallmark feature on biopsy. Next, to visualize which of these structures would you prefer MRI over CT scan? Now, for mucormycosis, CT scan is one of the best investigations. It's cheap, it's easily available everywhere, and it will give you extremely good pictures so that you can see the extent of the fungus. Okay? But in some areas, you cannot use a CT scan. You have to use an MRI or prefer an MRI over CT. So that is when there is invasion of what? Brain only, brain and orbit, brain orbit and palate, or all structures. So I have a few people saying B, Prakhar, Shahid, Subrasmita, Gopika, Nistala, then we have Javed also, and Rajeshwari saying C, then we have Tina saying C, and then Tina again saying B. Viral, MS Lakshmi are all saying C. Okay, so the correct answer over here is brain and orbit, as most of you have answered. Okay, so whenever we are looking at soft tissue structures, then in that case we have to prefer an MRI. MRI brain, MRI orbit will give you a much better idea about the invasion of these structures by mucormycosis. Okay? Alright. Which of these tests will help in best identification of white fungus? Now, this is the only question about white fungus which I have put because I did not get time to put about white and yellow fungus, but I will be doing that in another one of the sessions. I'll keep you guys informed. So, but one question about white fungus, which of these tests will help in identification of white fungus? PCR, ELISA, 1,3 beta D glucan assay, or MRI? Yes, bones are seen better on CT and soft tissues are seen better on MRI. So your palate is a bone, so it would be better seen on CT scan. Okay, good. So everyone knows 1,3 beta D glucan assay, but can anyone tell me what is the other assay which will help in identifying Aspergillus? There is one more assay. Does anyone know the name of that assay? One more. Along with 1,3 beta D, one more assay will help you in identifying Aspergillus species. Anyone? Gopika, you're close. Yes, very good, Anisha. Anisha, Pritika, very good. So, galactomannan assay. Galactomannan assay is the other test that will help you in identifying the white fungus. Okay. Next question. Which of these is not a treatment step for mucormycosis? So now we have finished with the diagnosis. Now we are going to the treatment. Okay, so we started off with the where it has originated from, distribution of the disease, then what is the causative factor, what are the clinical symptoms, what is the diagnostic modality. Now we are going to the treatment of mucormycosis. So which of these is not a treatment step? Antifungals treat the underlying cause, radical debridement till bleeding occurs, or conservative debridement. Okay, very good. Conservative debridement is the answer. It is not a treatment step for mucormycosis. So you need to remove the entire tissue. So if I show you in the picture over here, you need to remove the entire tissue, bone, whatever is affected by this mucormycosis. So till you reach till the blood vessels start bleeding, till you reach till that stage, so that you know you have removed the involved blood vessels also which were thrombosed. Okay, so you need to see fresh bleeding to be able to know that this blood vessel will now not be blocked by this fungus. Okay, so this is how you identify about mucormycosis. Okay, now I have a question for you guys. What is the first step? So if a patient comes to you with black eschar formation, what will you do first? Will you first start him on antifungals or will you first debride? Okay, I'm sorry about the lag, guys. I don't know why this is happening. Okay, so most of you are saying that the first thing you will do is debridement. Absolutely correct. So surgical debridement is the first thing. Okay, remove whatever is the tissue affected. You have to stop the fungus from going in further, because by the time you start antifungals, by the time they reach their therapeutic drug levels in the blood, the fungus would have already invaded more and more vessels and caused more destruction, and the patient will die out of sepsis. Okay, so as a result of this, or fungemia, so please make sure that first you have to stop the growth of the fungus, the further growth of the fungus. So you debride all the unhealthy tissue first. Make sure that you have removed how much ever possible of the fungal involvement part, and then you start the antifungals. Okay, alright. Which of these drugs is or are given for treatment of mucormycosis? Liposomal amphotericin B, posaconazole, isavuconazole, all of the above. Okay, yes, so you can use all of them. Absolutely correct, you can use all of the above. Now tell me, which is the first line treatment out of all of them? If you have to prefer one of them, what is the first line treatment for mucormycosis? You guys can write it in the chat box. What is the first line treatment of mucormycosis? Yes, absolutely correct. So liposomal amphotericin B is the drug of choice, or it is the first line treatment. Anyone, do you know the dose of liposomal amphotericin B? I want to know the dose of liposomal amphotericin B, if any of you all know. So tell me two things. One is the dose, one is the CDC recommended dose, because CDC is saying that you should start with higher doses. Okay, and the third thing is advantage of liposomal amphotericin B over conventional amphotericin B. Okay, so actually the dose is just 1.5 mg to 5 mg per kg per day. Okay, but according to the CDC, they are saying that now use higher doses of this. So they are suggesting to use 5 to 10 mg per kg per day. Okay, now what I need to know from you guys is, what is the advantage of liposomal amphotericin B over conventional amphotericin B? Why are you giving it in a liposomal preparation? Yes, Yes, so Prakhar is absolutely correct. There are two reasons. One is that lipoamphotericin B is less nephrotoxic, and second is it causes less thrombophlebitis as compared to conventional amphotericin B. Okay, are we clear? Alright. So how does it act? This also they might ask you in the exam, I'm not very sure about it, but you should know the mechanism of action of amphotericin B. It will bind to ergosterol. As you guys know, ergosterol is an important component of the fungal cell wall. So once it binds to this ergosterol, it creates this pore or an opening inside the cell membrane or the surrounding whatever, the cell membrane of the fungus. And as a result of this, the intracellular contents will all move outside. So your sodium, your potassium, all your intracellular contents will start moving outside, and as a result of this, there will be cell death finally. Okay? So this is what happens when you give amphotericin B. You have to just remember binding to ergosterol, formation of a pore in the fungal cell wall, which leads to cell death. Alright. In a patient on amphotericin B, which of these side effects should be monitored? Electrolyte imbalance, fever, rash, thrombophlebitis, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, all of the above. How to learn antifungal mechanism of action? Very confusing. Okay, I will take another set of flashcards for it then to make it easier for you guys to remember. I'm sorry about the lag, guys. I don't know why that is happening today. The internet seems absolutely fine. I'm really unsure. Hopefully it won't be there in the next class. Okay, all of the above, absolutely correct. So I just put this question because I wanted to list down all the side effects of amphotericin B. So all of this, so you every day you need to check. So how will this come in a case scenario is they will ask you, this is a patient of mucormycosis. They'll give you an image, then they'll say he has been started on amphotericin B. Which of these side effects should be looked for? Which test should be done every day? So every day you'll be checking his serum electrolytes level, you'll be checking his temperature. Be careful of using of having anti-allergics ready, because it is often seen that you see allergic response to AMB. So you should have all your anti-allergics as well as paracetamol ready, because patients often develop fever and rash. Thrombophlebitis hota hai, that's why we use bigger IV lines. Okay, so preferably a 16 gauge or an 18 gauge IV line, or the best thing to do is to put a central line and then give the drug through it. Okay, and finally nausea, vomiting and diarrhea ke liye you can give antiemetics and you can hydrate the patient. Okay, so all these things should be ready. If they ask you what test will you do or what things will you keep ready, you should have an idea about what should be done in a patient who is on amphotericin B. Alright, now I think this is the last question. Yes, okay. So while using posaconazole for treatment of mucormycosis, what should be the therapeutic drug level in the plasma? So we discussed amphotericin B in detail. Now posaconazole just a little bit. So you need to know what is the therapeutic drug level of posaconazole in the plasma. More than 0.2, more than 0.4, more than 0.5 or more than 1 mg per liter. This is the most difficult question, I think. All of you are confused now. Okay, so Shahid, Tina are saying more than 0.4 mg per liter. Then we have Javed saying more than 0.2. Prakhar and Subrasmita, Sujit all saying more than 0.5. I'm still waiting for someone to answer it correctly. Okay, so Neeraj Tripathi has answered it correctly. So the answer is more than 1 mg per liter. Okay, so usually what happens is if a patient is not compliant to amphotericin B or does not want to stay in the hospital, then you can tell him, okay, we'll give you posaconazole. This drug can be given at home. It does not require, it does not have many side effects and it does not require to be monitored a lot. Okay, So we give posaconazole, but it's important that it reaches its therapeutic drug levels of more than 1 mg per liter of the plasma to be able to be of some use to the patient. Okay, so this is the therapeutic drug level of posaconazole. Okay, so that is it for today's class. We have discussed in detail everything about mucormycosis. So we did distribution, then causative organism, clinical features, diagnosis, and treatment. Now we are left with yellow fungus and white fungus. So either I will add those things to tonight's lecture at 9 p.m. So please remember, guys, today at 9 p.m. we are going to be discussing the AIIMS COVID update. For everyone who's giving INICET, this is a highly important piece of document. So how to treat mild, moderate, severe cases of COVID-19 as per AIIMS. So we'll be discussing that, and I'll see if I can add some questions from yellow and white fungus to it. Okay. Tomorrow 11 a.m. we have surgical 20 must know surgery instruments and their uses, and then at 4 p.m. we have flashcard of medicine part 4. Why no classes in the app? Okay, so I am going to be taking classes in the app also, and don't worry, but that's just next week. I am not prepared with many of them because right now I had a hectic YouTube schedule. So I will be taking those next week, hopefully from 9th onwards. And I also have a plus course next week in which we will be revising the whole of anesthesia for the next 2022 batch. Okay. Any more doubts? Do you guys have any requests for any kinds of classes before INI, before FMG? I would be happy to take it for you guys. Today time is 9 p.m. Tomorrow again 11 a.m. and 4 p.m. Is there any other thing that you guys want to discuss, or you all want some topics? You also know that you can write to me on this Telegram group, Ace Neat PG with Dr. Janvi. So you can either ask me on that, or you can even mention it right now. Yeah, so most of it I have covered. I don't think there is anything left regarding mucormycosis. If I do come along questions which I feel is important for the exam point of view, I will add to it. Okay. Ophthal flashcards. Theek hai. Pediatrics course. Morning class was is there, ma'am. Anesthesia must know for INICT. Theek hai. I can see a lot of you want revision lectures. Theek hai. We'll do anesthesia also. No problem. Okay. Thank you. And I will see you at 9 p.m. tonight.